Okay, the doors are closed. One member of the program committee suggested that when we were pinning the subject of the next conference to security, the audience would double. Anyhow, security is important. Today, this talk is all about security of users logging in, as remembering all those different credentials is a little bit difficult. I know this because I forced my mother to every time type her password on her Chromebook, and she tends to type a .nl after it. Well, she knows she lives in the Netherlands, but the password doesn't have to know that. There must be a better way, so Joost tells us all about it. Joost of Surfnet, go on.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. So the topic of my talk will be FIDO 2 and web authentication. So my goal is to explain what it is and what we are using it for at Surfnet. So first, a little bit about myself. I've been working for Surfnet, which is the, you could say, the internet service provider for higher education and research in the Netherlands. And my job is to improve the security and usability of authentication in our community. I've been doing so for over 10 years, and different projects that I undertook to help improve this security. For example, Ticker is one of the applications we developed for making authentication more user-friendly. And actually, I gave a talk about that on one of the NLUUG conferences previously. Another topic was Surf Secure ID, which is our shared service for two-factor authentication, which we offer to our community. And now we are very enthusiastic about FIDO2 because it solves a lot of problems that we have encountered in the past with secure authentication. So this new technology I'm talking about is actually FIDO2. So Surfnet is one of the members of the World Wide Web Consortium, which is involved in the FIDO2 project. We are a voting member, so we were allowed to vote earlier this year about the FIDO2, or actually about the web authentication part of FIDO2. Of course, we voted yes, because we like FIDO. I don't think if we had voted no that everything would be canceled or anything, but this is a very important technology for us. We are not affiliated with FIDO, the FIDO Alliance, that is responsible for speccing all everything that's concerning FIDO2. So my goal is not as a FIDO Alliance member to push any technology on you. I was just I'm just here to tell you about why we think FIDO2 is important, and personally I think you should think so too. So this is Surf Secure ID service that we are offering. We've integrated U2F a couple years ago. So U2F is one of the examples of the FIDO sort of specification of the FIDO Alliance. U2F is about, it stands for Universal Second Factor, and the idea is to augment your authentication with a second factor. So there's a picture of a YubiKey, like, who of you knows YubiKey? Anyone that doesn't know what a YubiKey is? So YubiKey is a very simple device. It acts like a keyboard, and it generates one-time passwords. Looks very similar to the modern FIDO keys, like a U2F key, only the inner workings are completely different. And it has many usability and security benefits that I'm going to talk about shortly. But U2F has been around for a while, and if you've never heard of it, well, that's probably because it didn't exactly fail, but browser support was lacking. And that's one of the reasons why it never took off in our community, because our universities, they didn't want to support any technology that was basically only available in Google Chrome. So recently, this has improved because today, many browsers support FIDO2. And we are very happy about this. And so let's find out what FIDO is and why it is important. So FIDO is not all this. Who remembers the FIDO net? Let's see who's over 40 here. It's also not about a beverage or about dogs. It's about FIDO Alliance, which is a consortium of companies that are, well, involved in strong authentication, like browser vendors, like Google, Chrome, Microsoft with Edge. Also about token vendors, like Yubico, which produces keys, so authenticators, and Phishing, and many different, many other companies. But also relying parties, so parties like ServNet, who like to use this technology to secure their services. And this year has been a very good year because there's actually two different specifications that emerged. One by the World Wide Web Consortium called Web Authentication, and one by the FIDO Alliance called CTAP, which stands for Client to Authenticator Protocol. So these two specifications, they work in concert to secure login on, for example, the web, but also on applications and platforms. So what's the difference between web authentication and CTAP? Well, here's a typical scenario where a user wants to log in to some service using a web browser, and for stronger authentication, uses a security token, a FIDO2 token. So web authentication is involved in allowing the servers to authenticate a user using this token. So web authentication is basically a JavaScript API that is implemented in the browser. So browser vendors need to support web authentication by enabling this API. And CTAP is on the other leg between the browser and the user, for the user to use his token to prove his identity. So in this talk, I'm just going to talk about both parts, the web authentication part and the CTAP part. So let's zoom in on these tokens. What are they? Well, there's actually two types. One is called one are called roaming authenticators. The others are called platform authenticators. So roaming authenticators are these small devices. I've brought a couple of them. Typically USB tokens, similar to a plain old YubiKey, but the inner workings are completely different, and it has many benefits that I'll show you. And there's actually many vendors. So the nice thing about this CTAP protocol is that it's more or less an open standard. So anyone can build these kind of tokens. And today there are several vendors that are actually producing tokens like this. So there's some other samples here. The blue one is by Yubico. It's called the YubiKey security key. The white ones are from Google, the Titan key that you may have heard of. On the left are Phishing keys, which are interesting because they have fingerprint scanners, so you can leverage your fingerprint to have biometric authentication. And on top, it's very interesting that those are Solo keys. Solo is a three-man company, basically, and they provide open hardware implementations of FIDO keys. So you can actually build one yourself, or you can order them, and it's pre-assembled. But it's completely open. Not only the firmware, but also the hardware. It's completely open. It doesn't use any secure elements or whatever that require an NDA or anything. It's fully open. And the latest incarnation is the red one. That's a nano version that you can leave in your USB port. And there's also this ring, the token ring. Interesting. I don't think it's available yet, but you can actually... It's token ring, yeah. It's like... Who's old enough to know token ring? Cool. They actually call it token ring. I think it's a cool name. So those are roaming authenticators, and there's also platform authenticators. So these are authenticators that are built into a platform, like, for example, Android. So on the right-hand side, you see a user interface that whenever you authenticate using your Android phone, so your Android phone is basically a FIDO token, and then it can use your fingerprint scanner to do biometric authentication. And there's also the Windows Hello logo. Can I say the word Windows here? Because people were laughing. Actually, Windows is Microsoft Windows has the best implementation of FIDO2 at the moment. So every security feature you would like is implemented in Microsoft Edge. Talk about that in a moment. There's also the Touch ID. So, for example, my Mac, it has a touch bar, so I can use my fingerprint on the on my Mac to use my Mac as an authentication token. So these FIDO tokens are actually ubiquitous, and especially the what I like is the availability of Windows Hello and Android as tokens, because my mission in at Surfnet is to introduce two-factor authentication in the complete Surfnet community, so not only IT staff, but also students. Well, students, they're not going to buy these tokens because it costs money. Students have no money, I've heard. But they usually do have an Android phone, which is actually much more expensive than a token, but, well, anyway. So this enables strong authentication for the masses. So our complete user population of 1.5 million people in the Netherlands can in the future use this technology to strongly authenticate to services that, for example, we offer at Surfnet. Maybe it's a good idea to have a demo. So this is a demo site. It's built by Duo Labs, which is now owned by Cisco. It's a very nice implementation. It's open source, actually, so you can run it yourself. So let's try to do a demo. So at this site, I can, well, the site that I'm seeing, but you're not. Try this way. So there's actually two operations with the FIDO token. First one is registration. The other one is authentication. And that's basically it. So there's just two operations. And they are available in this JavaScript API. And of course, with registration, then the site should somehow verify your identity. So that's not implemented here because it's completely open. But let's first register an account. So let's suppose that my identity has been proven somehow, something like this. So first, I say let's register a key. So now I have my fingerprint scanner key here. I can insert it in a USB port and then use my fingerprint. To register. So now it's not that my fingerprint is now registered at this site, but my security key is registered. So it has created some cryptographic material on the key and did an exchange with the server. So now the server has my key registered, and with this key I can now authenticate. So it says, okay, I'm successfully registered. So let's now try to log in. So again, I get a pop-up asking me to authenticate. I prove my identity with my fingerprint to my token, and my token uses the previously registered key. And I'm logged in. So this is a very boring demo, and that's exactly the way we like it, because authentication is a hassle, and we want it to be frictionless. And, well, I think this is pretty frictionless if you have a key, or maybe use Touch ID on your phone or on your Mac. So that's basically it. Well, I'm not finished with my presentation yet, though. Let's find out how it works. Let's try to find my slides. So let's focus on the web authentication part. So a typical application, like the demo I just showed you, it contains on of a web application, and my browser plays a role in this, in that my browser exposes the web authentication API with the register and the authenticate methods. And the web application can use this API to trigger an authentication using, for example, my YubiKey token. So the web application contains a server-side part and a client-side part. The server-side typically generates a challenge that we'll have a look at later, asking, in the end, my token to sign this challenge and return a response. So the server-side generates a challenge, sends it to the client. And typically on the client there's some JavaScript that then calls this web authentication API to trigger either a registration or an authentication. So this challenge plays an important role. It gets signed by the software on the key, and the response is sent back as a result of this JavaScript call. And then the client-side JavaScript can forward this result back to the server. The server can then verify the response, and if everything works out, then it has proof, cryptographic proof, that the right key has been used for authentication. So this JavaScript API is pivotal. It needs to be implemented in the browser, so it's not like a JavaScript library that you can download with the rest of the JavaScript from the server. Now it has to be implemented in the browser. Unfortunately, most browsers actually implement this JavaScript API today, so you can actually use this today. So whenever you call this this API, your browser will generate a pop-up. So this is a pop-up generated by your browser, not by JavaScript directly. So this is not part of the user interface from the web application. This is a dialogue from your browser asking you to use your security key. And you get this pop-up either when you register or when you authenticate. So the rest of this talk will be about why we love this technology. So what are the benefits, for example, for us or for our users in using FIDO2 tokens? So I'm not going to zoom in on every one of them, but these are the ones that I could come up with. I'm not going to read them out. I'm just going to pick one of them. For example, these keys are affordable. So the platform keys, they are actually in your platform, so you don't have to buy anything. But even if you want to have a roaming authenticator, which can be very handy because you can actually transfer identity from one device to another, you can buy a roaming authenticator on eBay or on bol.com or Amazon. And there's actually plenty of choice from many vendors. And they're not that expensive. So for a... Sorry? Well, they're cheaper than this. So the solo keys, for example, I think they are 20 euros. It's not... Yeah. So it's not cheap in that you can easily buy these for your complete community. But if you compare them with traditional tokens, like RSA Secure ID, then it's much, much more expensive. So relatively, for a security device, this is actually not very expensive, I think. But if it is too expensive, you can just ask people to use an Android phone or Windows Hello or a touch bar. So it doesn't have to be expensive. Yes, question? Yeah, iOS is a little difficult, of course, because it's Apple. And for a long time, I thought I had given up hope that Apple would actually do anything with FIDO2. But then there was Safari 12.1, and it has web authentication as an experimental feature. So out of the blue, they just implemented it. So that's very good news. It's not in, it's not enabled by default yet. You have to manually enable it, but it's there. And usually, these technologies become mainstream, so enabled by default in a while. It's actually also on your iOS version of Safari, except that you cannot use it because there's no way to use USB, NFC, or Bluetooth Low Energy at the moment. But I guess it's a sign that something will be happening there soon. I hope. So what is very important to us is that this is actually strong authentication. So the cryptographic key material that is generated is actually stored in secure hardware. It doesn't have to be, but there's actually a way to check if it is. But secure hardware is very important because we have a service that is called strong authentication. And strong authentication means that you have multiple factors. So not only something you know, but also something you are or something you have. And it is not possible to have something, so have a something you have factor without secure hardware. So there's many solutions that are called two-factor authentication, which are in fact not two-factor, because if you have cryptographic key material that is used in a security protocol, well, this material has to be secret. And it's very hard to keep a secret. So you actually need secure hardware to keep a secret. If you store it in a database, and well, the database can get copied or cloned or whatever. And this means you have a copy of your device, your security device. So it's actually not a what you have vector, because someone else also has this vector. So you need something like a security chip, and there's many examples. So there's many different technologies, like Secure Enclave by Apple, or trusted execution environments, or secure elements in your on your SIM card or whatever. But FIDO2 is actually written to be able to use this secure element or trusted hardware to store your keys. So it's actually two-factor authentication. Also important is that there's no shared secrets in the protocol. It uses public key cryptography, and that's also very important because here are some traditional methods for strong authentication. And for example, this RSA token, it actually uses secure hardware, so that's secure, but it's also based on a shared secret technology. That means there's a secret somewhere in this device stored securely, but because it's a shared secret, there's a copy of the secret on the server that you're authenticating to. So, and that goes for all these technologies, even also the YubiKey. So YubiKey has a security key, a FIDO2 key, but this is a traditional key that generates one-time passwords. And this is, of course, more secure than a normal password, but it's a solution for password reuse, to prevent people from reusing the same password elsewhere. But it's not a protection against phishing or compromise of a database, because the database on the server has to contain all these secrets. In that respect, it's actually worse than passwords, because passwords you can salt and hash and whatever. But these secrets have to be stored either plain text or also in secure hardware, which makes it kind of expensive. So symmetric keys are actually a risk, because a hacker could steal one password from the client, or potentially millions of secrets on the server if those secrets are not well protected. So this makes it very complex to build a secret key-based solution for strong authentication. Whereas if you have public keys, well, then the only secret is on the authenticator itself. The public key, by definition, is public. So, of course, you have to protect your database that someone cannot alter the database. But if the database leaks, that's not really a problem, because it's not a secret. Anyone can know the public key. So this is a very nice property. Question? No. By design, you cannot export the private key.
So if you authenticate, you destroy your lockout?
Sorry, if you lose your authenticator?
Yeah.
Yeah. If you lose your authenticator, you cannot use the private key anymore. So the solution is usually to have multiple keys. For example, a platform authenticator with a key and a roaming authenticator with a key. So maybe you've heard of Google's Advanced Protection Program. It requires you to have two keys. So the Advanced Protection Program is for journalists or political activists or people that really care about their security of their Google account. So Google has this Advanced Security Program where you can actually lock down your account using FIDO2. But it does require you to have two keys for in case you lose one, because there's no way to restore your account if you lose it. Yeah. So for cryptocurrencies, that would be very harsh. If you lose your key, you would lose your money. So that's a different use case. For cryptocurrencies, I can imagine that vendors make the key exportable so you can safely store it, but have a copy in a safe somewhere. Yeah. But that's really a different use case. So for FIDO2, you just need several keys.
Yeah. Who owns the verifier?
Who owns the verifier?
Yeah.
You do. Anyone who deploys FIDO2 keys has to store the public keys. So this is different from, for example, X509 personal certificates, where public keys are verified using a CA, for example, or or identity federation, where you have a central component doing the storing the public keys. FIDO2 is meant to be implemented by everyone, and it has to be simple to implement. Unfortunately, it is quite simple. It's actually more simple than using password authentication, I think. You have to do some extra, use a library of some kind, but there's actually many, many libraries today available in many different languages, like Go, C, PHP, Java, that you can just use to deploy this technology in your own service.
But in that case, the only thing I can assure is that it's the same authentication key which is coming again and again.
Yes.
There's no way that there is any verification on the user itself.
Correct. So this FIDO protocol authenticates the key, and not directly the user, but there is a way to bind a user to the key, for example, what I just did with my fingerprint. So I'm the only one who can operate this FIDO key. But the verifier... Sorry? Oh, my finger, yeah. That's true, my finger. Everyone who cuts off my finger... Yeah, I haven't actually tried, if I cut off my finger, if I can still authenticate. This is something I still have to find out. Yeah, true. So the registration I just did, that's cheating a little bit, because that's not how it should go. So for example, if we take our service, Surf Secure ID, where we onboard users that are allowed to access security-sensitive services, for example, ADP.com or roster information, they first have to have a face-to-face ceremony before they can register a key. So FIDO2 is about authentication, not about identification. So there still has to be some process to enroll users. But it really depends on your use case. For example, Google doesn't really care. So Google has this technology enabled for you to lock down your own account. So this is not on behalf of the relying party. This is on behalf of yourself. Whereas we at SURF, we do this for our universities, and they really want to make sure that anyone who logs in using this key is actually the person that is who he says he is. So there we have an identity vetting process enabled to bind an authenticator to an actual person. So, and that's out of scope from FIDO2. FIDO2 is just about the authentication step. So a bit about this challenge response. This is to prevent replay. Well, this is actually possible with many different technologies, but just to illustrate. So there's a verifier and an authenticator, and in this case, I left out the client, which is the browser, for example. But just to illustrate the principle, this challenge response using public key cryptography, it's just about generating some random challenge, so a nonce, that's a challenge that you only use once. Send it to the authenticator and ask the authenticator to sign it with the private key that is generated before. So the response is basically a signature over the challenge. It is sent back to the verifier, and the verifier can repeat the process with the public key, so that the public key corresponding to this private key, and then can verify that the signature belongs to the challenge that he just sent before. So this is a basic protocol which prevents replay. So as long as you use challenges that are fresh, so never used before, there's no way you can do replay. Some other features are user presence and user verification. So user presence, that just means that you have to be present to perform the authentication step. So you cannot do this with, like for example, with personal certificates, you can actually automate this and let the software do it. But the security keys, they require manual action, typically pressing a button, in which case it's user presence. Or even stronger, user verification, which means that the token is able to authenticate the user, for example, using a fingerprint. So I have here a YubiKey 5, which just has a button. So this is about normally about user presence. It doesn't have a fingerprint scanner, but you can protect it with a PIN. So if you want to have user verification, you can set a PIN on this thing, and if you authenticate, then your browser will pop up asking you for a PIN. So that's another way of binding a user to the token with something you know instead of something you are, like with the fingerprint. And that's very nice because it prevents these kinds of horrible pictures. So this is a picture by a blog post by Troy Hunt about someone who's pointing a camera on their secure ID tokens. And they generate one-time passwords, and he can use the camera to remotely scan the one-time passwords that he needs for authentication. So there's no user presence here. He's not there. Yet he can use this token, but that won't work with FIDO. You actually have to have the token in your hand. Then privacy. Privacy is also something I'm working on at Surfnet, and I really like FIDO tokens because one of the services we offer is for personal certificates, which are nice, for example, for sending email. We also use them for authentication, but it has a problem because your certificate is basically some kind of a super cookie. So if someone wants to track you, then he's very happy if you use certificates because these certificates, they have all kinds of unique information like a serial number or the public key itself. That's typically a unique identifier. And if you use this certificate the private key for your certificate to log in at different places, it means that it's very easy to track you. So with FIDO, that's different because you generate a new key pair for every site that you visit. So if I register at three sites, there are three register operations, meaning three times generating a key pair and sending the corresponding public key to the verifier. So these verifiers are unable to detect that the same key is used for either service. Question? So the question is, do I have to use the same browser? Now, for a roaming authenticator, no, because the private key is stored on your roaming authenticator. If it's a platform authenticator, then the answer is also no, but you do have to use the same device. So if you use an Android phone, only that Android phone has the private key. Another nice technology is device attestation, because we use this for strong authentication at our secure ID service. And we really, really want to know that the device that is used by an IT staff member is a secure one. Because as I said, it's completely open. Someone built a FIDO token using a Raspberry Pi, which doesn't do user verification or user presence even, because it doesn't have a button. You can just flash an SD card, put it in your Raspberry Pi, and it behaves as a FIDO token. But the secrets are stored on the SD card, so that's not very safe. And it does support FIDO, the protocol, so you could actually use it without service. But we don't like that, because we just want to accept secure hardware. Well, device attestation is a method of proving what kind of device you used for registration. And if you use it, you get an extra pop-up. So the browser generates this pop-up asking you if the relying party, the verifier, can see the make and model of your token. So this is device attestation. If you block this, then no attestation is possible. But we require attestation because then we have proof that it's actually, for example, a YubiKey that is being used or a Titan key instead of something else. I see a question. Yes, I think, so the question is, how can we make sure that it's not a Raspberry Pi? And I like that question because I have the answer here. So my diagram of this challenge response was a bit simple. There's actually a lot more going on. During registration, I don't only get a response from the authenticator, I also get a certificate. And the certificate is issued by, in this case, phishing, who built one of my keys. And there's a key on the device called the attestation key. And this key is able to sign the response message. So there's actually two keys. So I just generated a key pair. But there's also a generic key on there, the attestation key, that is used to sign a so-called attestation object. The attestation object contains the public key that I just created. And the attestation key is used to sign this attestation object. So as a relying party, I can verify the signature that is that is generated using this attestation key. So that's a private key burnt into the secure hardware. And I can verify it with this certificate. So the certificate is also part of the response. And I can verify the certificate using a root CA operated, in this case, by phishing, and validated by the FIDO Alliance. So the FIDO Alliance has this metadata service that contains a database with metadata about certified authenticator. So this phishing key is certified by the FIDO Alliance, and I can go to the FIDO Alliance, ask for the metadata, verify it by the signature again, and then use it to verify the signature on this certificate in order to verify that the public key is actually generated by a phishing key and not something else. So with the Raspberry Pi, this wouldn't work because Raspberry Pi, or the one who made the firmware for the Raspberry Pi, he didn't get certified by the FIDO Alliance. So one role of the FIDO Alliance is generating specs, so speccing how the FIDO protocol works, but also maintaining this metadata service that contains certified products. So the certification is also one of the tasks of the FIDO Alliance. Another question. Very good question, because I just said there's this private key that is being used to sign the attestation object. And I can use the public key, but then aren't we back to square one, where in the example I just gave with a personal certificate? And the answer is no, because the FIDO specs require that the same master key, so the same attestation key, is used for at least, say, 100,000 devices. So if Facian or Ubico or whoever generates a batch of keys, they are required to use the same attestation key on many, many devices. So, of course, there's less privacy. So that's the reason why there's this pop-up asking you to see the make and model of your authenticator. Because if you allow this, then the relying party knows you're probably one of at least 100,000 people. And this is very similar to Germany's Neue Personalausweis that also has this requirement. So that's a very advanced authentication method. And to protect privacy, they also have this requirement to have at least 100,000 devices carry the same attestation key. Yeah? Yes? Then there's trouble. So if somehow the attestation key is leaked because of bad practice or whatever, or maybe the hardware is not so secure as we thought it would be, then there's a certificate revocation list. So the FIDO Alliance can revoke the certificate for the attestation.
So lots of devices will be like...
Yeah. So, but it's up to you if you want to actually invalidate the devices, because someone authenticates and you know that it's the token that has a problem, and it's up to you, so you can detect, okay, this is a token that has possibly been compromised. I'm not sure if this is actually a phishing or a YubiKey. It could be a Raspberry Pi carrying the leaked secret. But it's up to you to decide if you want to still accept those keys, or you can just throw them away from your database and everyone has to re-register. That's up to the relying party.
Yeah, and buy new hardware.
And buy new hardware, yeah, definitely.
But
yeah.
It's only important for
safe.
Yeah, because that's true, because the private key that was registered, or the public key that was registered, assuming that the compromise or whatever happened afterwards, at that point you were sure that it was the right device. But then after the compromise, you can't know for sure yet, because anyone who registers a device proclaiming to be made by this vendor, definitely, yeah. So it's you have to rethink what you're going to do, and it really depends on what you're using it for, of course. Yep, almost done. One other thing that is not so important for us at Surfnet, because we use these keys as a second factor for step-up authentication. But I guess for the rest of the world, this is very nice. You can actually get rid of passwords altogether. And this was actually the initial motivation for the FIDO Alliance, to get rid of passwords because of all the usability and security issues with passwords. Their mission is actually to get rid of passwords altogether. And FIDO2 supports this. So let's do another demo. Try to do another demo. So I'm going to close this one. Try to close this one. So here's a demo where I can again use a key. Let's try another one, the YubiKey. I'm going to register myself. First, I have to supply a username and a password. Wrong password. Anyone else use this? Wrong username or password. Oh, wait, I already did this. I was testing this, I guess. Well, let's renew. Q1. What am I doing wrong? Yeah. You should never test your demos. Let's try again. Sorry. Now I get what you're telling me. Yeah. I have to register. My username gets shorter and shorter. And now I have to register. Yeah, thank you. And, welcome, Q. Okay, so I've registered, and now I'm going to add a security key. Do you have a security key? Yes. And I want to enable passwordless login, meaning that I don't want to use my password that I just registered ever again. It was also a very simple password, a one-character password. Doesn't matter, because I'm going to get rid of my password by using this security key. So I have to plug it in. Try to plug it in. It's a USB-C. Oh, it has a protection cap still on it. All right. I hope still in time. So here you see the user verification. So now the token, I actually registered a PIN on the token. And now the user interface is asking me for the PIN. And now I have to push the button. I want to allow device at the station. And I'm done. So if I now sign out and sign in again, so it's not asking me for a username. So the username is stored actually on the device together with the private key. And I can just push the button, enter the PIN to do user verification, and push the button, and I'm back in. Question? Yeah, if actually I'm not sure about the YubiKey. If I try too many times, it will block my device. Yeah. So that's, of course, because it's only four characters. I think I should stop here.
It's about time.
So if you have any other questions, I'll be here all day.